Hello again, design nerds. It's Devin here with Make Anything. And recently I shared some prints where I combined normal printing with fuzzy skin printing using multi-part models for what I call multi-texture printing. It's quite a beautiful effect, giving texture and life to prints without the waste and complications of multicolor printing. And beyond that, I think the look of a single color part with patterns and graphics created simply through texture variations is just a really fresh and satisfying look for 3D printing. Well, a lot of you agreed and wanted to learn how it's done. So in today's video, I'll be covering all the steps necessary to successfully print these multi-texture prints, and I'll even show you how to make your own from scratch in Autodesk Fusion. Let's do it. So I'm actually gonna go slightly out of order here for the sake of those of you who simply wanna know how to successfully print multi-texture designs like all of these ones I'm offering on Thangs. So first I'll cover the slicer settings for 3D printing these, and after that we'll jump into Fusion and design some models from scratch. We'll start out in Cheaty Slicer, which is really just a reskin of Cura, so everything should be about the same. First, let's make sure we're in expert mode, so we have access to all the settings, and then we'll go ahead and import the main body. For this moss planter, I've included some 3MF files with things preset, but for the sake of this tutorial, we'll do everything manually. So let's select the main planter file here, and it's just like the container file, but with these drainage holes for housing living plants. Anyways, we can see the body here with voids where we want fuzziness. So to add those parts in alignment to this main body, we'll go to this parts list, right click the body, and go down to add part and load. We'll select the corresponding fuzzy file, and now we've got a multi-part model. For our base settings, I have the default 0.2 millimeter fine print settings loaded. 0.16 millimeter height also works well, but I'll go for 0.2 here to get things done a little more quickly. I can also switch to lightning infill, which is super sparse, since the fuzziness will already add strength to our walls. We can also lower the default value for solid infill threshold area, which will also prevent some unnecessary infill. That's it for the general settings, so now we can apply some special settings just to the fuzzy part. On the parts list, I'll right-click that fuzzy part, go down to Add Settings, and add all of the fuzzy skin settings. Now go back to add another setting for infill density, and one final time for perimeters. Now we can modify all those settings down here, so I'll set one perimeter, 0% infill, and of course we'll turn fuzzy skin on, with a 0.5 millimeter point distance and 1 millimeter skin thickness. You're welcome to experiment with those numbers, but I find this makes a really nice fluffy looking part. So let's slice this and check our preview. All right, it's looking good from the outside, although I do like to paint on a seam to have it hidden from more angles. So I'll do that with a wavy seam on the inside. And for the outside, we can just do a little seam at the brim and the bottom. Cura will automatically hide the other seams inside of these hidden edges, so this will do. Slice again, and sweep through the layers to check for hiccups. You can see how minimal that lightning infill is, just a bit near the base and then way up on the rim. So we've got an estimated print time of 4 hours, but we're really only using 60 grams of filament. Fuzzy skin just prints a bit slowly, but this is good to go. Preparing a part like this in Bambu Studio or Orca Slicer involves just a few slight differences. Firstly, we can import the two bodies together by dragging them both into the program at once, and then selecting yes on this prompt about treating them as a single object with multiple parts. Now we can edit the parts separately using this objects menu. Select the fuzzy part, and then we'll set infill to 0, wall loops to 1, and enable fuzzy skin under the other settings. As we did in Cura, we can set the global infill pattern to lightning, and we'll also draw on our custom seam. Now we'll check our preview, and whoops, I forgot to adjust the fuzzy skin values. So you can get an idea of the default look here, but I'll use my custom values for that super fluffy appearance. Oh, and let's also reduce that minimum sparse infill threshold value. And with those changes, we've got the print time down to just 2.5 hours on my zippy Bambu X1 Carbon. Nice. I've been printing these using ColorFabb's Moss Green Stonefill filament, and while it is a rather abrasive and fickle filament, it's also kind of a perfect fit for this design, just further adding to the organic look and feel. So there we go, a successfully printed multi-texture moss planter ready to house a happy houseplant. Now that we've got that handled, let's see what it actually takes to design one of these multi-texture models from scratch over in Fusion. Okay, so in Fusion, we'll start as we most often do, with a new sketch on the front plane. I'll draw a vertical line up from the origin, and right-click on that to change it to a center line. Now we'll make a half profile of a super simple planter, just a rectangle that will be revolved to make a cylinder. Let's use the dimension tool to make the diameter 100 millimeters, and let's go with 60 millimeters from top to bottom. A short little planter. Now we'll select the revolve tool, which will create that cylinder for us. Then we'll create a chamfer on the bottom edge, 2 millimeters, and we'll fill it the top edge that creates at 3 millimeters. I still see designers using full fillets on bottom edges like this, and it hurts my soul because that is just asking for some poor bed adhesion and ugly overhangs. Hence this chamfer to keep the overhang at or below 45 degrees. Before we finesse this shape any further, let's start preparing our fuzzy bits by selecting our body in the parts browser, and we'll copy and paste that to make a duplicate body. Hide the new body and then select the top of the first body and use the shell tool to make a 4 millimeter shell. Nice and thick to complement our fluffy aesthetic. Now we'll switch which body is visible and create a similar shell, but set this one to both directions with an inside thickness of 2 millimeters and 1 millimeter for the outside thickness. At this point, it's good to open the appearance panel with shortcut A, and we'll duplicate the default material to make a few different colors and drag those onto our parts so it's easier to keep track of them. This first body I made will be our main part, so I'll just go ahead and add a 2 millimeter fillet to these top edges for a nice full round. Now let's make the second body visible, which will become our fuzzy bits. I'll extrude down from the top edge to create a margin for the brim. Let's do minus 5 millimeters and make sure that it's only applied to body 2. Then on the bottom, I'll sketch a big circle and use that to cut away from the bottom, once again only on body 2, and minus 7 millimeters feels like a nice bottom limit here. I'll rename my bodies, better late than never. And now to prepare for our pattern sketch, I'm going to use the measure tool set to the highest precision. Select the outer edge of this part and click on the length to copy that value to your clipboard. Next, we'll create a new sketch from one of our vertical planes and project the edges of this body into our sketch. We'll use those to constrain this center construction line, and then we'll add a center point rectangle from the center point of that line and constrain that to the top and bottom edges to match the height of our part. Then add a width dimension and paste in the circumference measurement we took earlier to make a rectangle that would perfectly wrap around our cylinder. Except sometimes you have to slightly decrease that value to make this technique work. To test this out, I'll just draw an arbitrary circle within this rectangle, and now let's finish the sketch and find the emboss tool under this create menu. I'll select the rectangular profile and the outer cylinder for the face, along with the deboss effect. But we're getting an error as is. I can instead deboss just the circle, but that's not what we're going for here. So let's go back into our previous sketch, and if we decrease that rectangle width a bit more, we can get the emboss tool to work mostly as intended. There is now a little sliver of a body left over, but we'll remove that later. For now, we can hop back into that rectangle sketch and start creating our fuzzy pattern. I decided to give this planter a sprinkles theme, that is, a lot of simple, semi-random shapes scattered across the surface. So I'll just start adding profiles. By the way, whenever you want to avoid all of the automatic constraints that Fusion tries to add, just hold down Control while sketching lines or moving things to prevent that from happening. That's a necessary tip for something like this, where I'm basically improvising this chaotic pattern. We've got some circles, pill shapes, triangles, and crosses. So let's click Finish Sketch and go down to our timeline and right-click and edit the emboss feature. We'll clear the sketch profiles and reselect the rectangle, and just like that, all of our new shapes are created. Upon seeing this result, I do feel like the shapes could take up a bit more space on the planter, so using that project timeline on the bottom, I can go back and edit my earlier extrude cuts, decreasing the size of my top and bottom margins. That will adjust the size of the working area in my pattern sketch, and I can shift and transform my shapes a bit more to fill that space. Okay, that's looking better. At this point, we may as well remove this little residual body, and we'll keep making adjustments as we go along. That's the beauty of parametric modeling. Next, I'll use the fillet tool to round the points of all my triangles to 2 millimeters to keep going with this super round, soft vibe. And after that, another fillet, this time on the front surface of all these shapes. 2 millimeters here makes these shapes look really puffy. Next, we'll keep rounding everything out by selecting the inside faces, which will be hidden within our print, but removing sharp edges should help the fuzzy skin print more easily. Actually, I'll just select the entirety of our fuzzy parts and give them a 0.9 millimeter radius. That maximum radius is often limited by the sizes of other radii created beforehand, so the order of operations can affect what's possible, but this'll do for this design. So, our shapes are looking soft and satisfying, but if we do a section analysis of our model, we can see that there is still an overlap between parts. To rectify that, let's go to Modify and select the Combine tool. And just as a reminder, you can always add your own shortcuts through this menu, as I have for this tool since I use it in nearly every project. The main body is our target, and let's make this a cut operation and check Keep Tools as well. Then we'll select all the remaining parts. That cuts away any overlapping bodies, but leaves our fuzzy parts intact and embedded in our planter. To further improve this soft and fuzzy effect, let's select all of the edges where the fuzzy parts were cut away, and we'll give those a fillet as well. Here, we're limited again to 0.9 millimeters because of this small radius here, and that did make me realize that I could make these plus shapes a little nicer by going back and adding a fillet to these inner corners before rounding out the rest. That didn't end up changing the size of their minimum radius, but it looks better in any case. Anyways, after just a bit more finessing, I got to this point that I'm happy with for the pattern. For some final steps, I'm going to extrude cut down from the inside of the pot to make the bottom surface just 1.2 millimeters thick, since any more is unnecessary, and I'll fillet the inside edges to smooth the transition from the bottom to the walls. I'll also cut a few 10 millimeter holes through the bottom to make this a functional planter that I can pair with any of my multitude of drip trays that I've designed. Okay, our design is complete for now, so I'll export the model as 2 STL files. First, we'll right-click the main part and save as mesh. Then hide that part so only the fuzzy parts are visible. Right-click here on the top of the feature tree and select Save as Mesh there, which should combine all the visible bodies as one part so that all our fuzzy bits are connected. That brings us back to the slicer portion of the process, which I already demonstrated earlier. So here's what the slicer preview looks like, and it's off to the printer. So I technically did still go multicolor with this print by using Chidi's Rapido Rainbow Silk PLA filament. It just seemed to suit the playful sprinkle theme. But still, just take a look at how absolutely fluffy this looks. The combination of soft shapes and slicer settings makes for a super effective result. Naturally, this was just one very specific way to use multi-texture printing, and the possibilities are really endless. Here's a carafe I designed using a repeated spiraling pattern rather than the embossing technique, and that also turned out looking quite lovely. I've already made quite a few planters and vases with this technique, but I am eager to use it for more functional purposes as well. Fuzzy skin has a ton of potential for creating grippy surfaces, so that's something else to keep in mind. And there we have it, a few new multi-texture models, and hopefully some new skills and inspirations for your future designs. I really look forward to seeing how we can push this technique further together, so maybe hop into the Make Anything Discord channel and share your fun fuzzy prints there. As for my designs, they'll be available on Thangs. I'll link to those in the description along with affiliate links for the various filaments and tools featured in this video, and links to Autodesk Fusion, who sponsor me by giving me access to their software. As always, I'm super grateful for my Patreon supporters who help support this channel financially. Nitty-gritty CAD tutorials like this are obviously not the most mainstream content, but I do love sharing my design knowledge, and I personally think videos like this are some of my most valuable. So if you agree and have the means, your memberships keep this ship sailing. So thank you. That's it for today, so I'll catch you in the next video. Until then, take care, stay awesome, and as always, stay inspired.